Okay, I guess I'll, the clock shows 6:30, best I can tell, so we'll go ahead and call this meeting to order. Asked for the roll call to be done, please.
Harper?
Here.
Petrie?
Present.
Schrader?
Here.
Shore?
Here.
Weibel? Berkson, or Ezri?
Here.
And Berkson.
And there's Pies.
Weibel.
So everyone's here. Thanks for coming. Move on then to approval of agenda and addenda. Is there such a motion? Moved by Mr. Shore, seconded by Mr. Schrader. Any additions, corrections to be made? And if not, all in favor, please say aye. Aye. All opposed, nay. Thank you. That passes. Move on then to approval of minutes of the ELEC committee meeting for August 6th, 2015. Moved by Mr. Schrader, seconded by Ms. Berkson. Any additions or corrections to those to be made? And seeing none, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay. Okay, thank you. That passes as well. We'll move on then to public participation. We have just the one right now, Ms. Jennifer Putnam. If you'd please come up and sit at the desk and turn the microphone on, please. Just the biggest button right at the bottom. There you go. Thank you.
I'm here as a member of the Board of Directors of the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. We are one of 16 co-sponsors of a community meeting that will be held Saturday, the 19th of September, at the Champaign Public Library. The hours are 10:30 to 12:30. I've placed a flyer that announces the event at each person's place, and Ms. Petrie will ensure that other members of the county board who aren't here tonight will. Thank you very much, Patsy, for making this available to others. As members of one of the 14 decision-making signatories to a consent decree on the landfill, I don't know the proper name of how to refer to this consent decree, but you have some big decisions to make on the consent decree. I want to stress that the healthcare consumers has not taken any position on the consent decree, and we will not. What we're trying to do is get out information throughout our county and through the 14 counties that host the Mahomet Aquifer to come and learn more about the issues that deal with the aquifer. I'm not sure what date the county board will vote on the consent decree. Do you have that date?
It's on the committee of the whole for the 8th of September under policy, and then depending what happens at the committee of the whole, okay, it might move to the county board meeting of September.
Well, in any event, no matter how you vote, the issues that surround the aquifer will continue after your vote on the consent decree. This is the resource that we are to be stewards of into practically as long as any of us shall live. So the fact that a decision on the consent decree may be over by the time of this meeting, your responsibility for the aquifer will not be ending. I don't envy any of you the decision that you'll be making. I sat through the Urbana City Council discussion and watched the discussion in the Champaign City Council, and I know some of you know how you're going to vote. Others, I think, are going to be weighing it and have sleepless nights, and I'm just very, very glad that the decision is one that you will make, and thank you for doing everything you can to learn more and more about it. We'd love to have you attend the meeting on the 19th if you're able to. Thank you.
Thank you. See no other public to participate, so we will move on then to communications from the members, committee members. Seeing none of those, we will then move on to section 7, the information part. A, we have the enforcement update for 1101 Carroll Avenue, Urbana. You going to take that, John?
We had a bid opening yesterday on the demolition of the 1101 Carroll Avenue. Unfortunately, we received four bids, but only one bid was complete. And there were a couple of different irregularities. So the state's attorney's office has advised that it needs to be rebid. But we're going to go ahead and have a budget amendment on the committee of the whole agenda for next week. It won't be based on an exact bid, but we feel we're still in the ballpark. So we're moving ahead with the budget amendment. And if that passes through the county board, we hope to have a new bid opening on or about October 1, so that hopefully still October we'll be moving ahead with demolition of this property.
Any questions? I guess I have one. What roughly budget amount? I mean, granted, this isn't budget where we make that decision, but what are you looking at?
Well, at this time, half of the bids were below $15,000, which was actually lower than we expected. When we rebid, you know, we're going to get different numbers, so we need to provide for that. But I think we'll still have good low bids.
Okay, thanks. Any other? Mr. Harper.
What's our chances of recouping on this lien against that property?
You know, if someone could buy a honest-to-goodness building lot for less than $20,000, that's a pretty good deal. So I think there's going to be a pretty good chance.
Mr. Weibel.
What is it zoned for?
I believe it's zoned R2, which is still a single-family zoning district.
Any other questions on that update? And if not, we'll then move on to B, the proposed fiscal year 2016 budget for the Department of Planning and Zoning.
I apologize for not having this on the committee agenda before it went to the budget hearing. I think you all were there the other night, and the biggest part of our cost savings is simply planning to have one less ZBA meeting than we normally would, which would still provide for more ZBA meetings than we've had this year. So I was happy that it was that easy to come up with the cuts. But I probably should have involved the committee a little bit more ahead of time. I apologize for that. I wanted it on the agenda tonight just in case there were any questions that didn't get asked the other night.
Any questions? Go ahead, Patsy.
I have a question. If you think you can get by with less ZBA meetings, is that going to be then a consistent pattern in the following years?
I guess that's up to the county board. We used to budget the ZBA based on the previous year's experience, and then we had a couple years where we had to have budget amendments, at which point the county administrator said, well, if you're supposed to have two meetings a month, why don't we just budget for 24 meetings, and then if we have some left over, great, and we don't have to worry about budget amendments. So that's what we've been doing. Again, the amount that we have in the FY16 budget would have been more than we needed for all but one of the past 5 years. So I don't really see a problem going into the future based on this amount.
Any Any other questions? Okay, we will move on then to C, the Township Road District Ordinance establishing fees required for consideration of proposed development projects. John again.
Yeah, this is just an information-only item. This Jeff Blue forwarded this to me on August 25th. I'm sorry the quality is so difficult to read, but when I read this, my immediate concern was for any special use permit that's proposed in a rural area, and we generally have one a month at the Zoning Board of Appeals, I mean, a literal reading would mean that those people need to pay $5,000 in fees in order to get comments from the highway commissioner. Now, maybe that's not really the intent of most highway commissioners, and I think it's entirely reasonable for them to want to recover some of their costs. But for example, it's not that unusual to have a special use permit that is for a project valued at $1 million or more, and this would require a $10,000 reimbursement to be set up for something like that. I think all of the premier co-op projects we've done the past couple years were all well more than $1 million. LA Gourmet was well more than $1 million. So maybe this won't be an issue, but I wanted to bring it to your attention ahead of time. And again, I think it's great that the road districts are going to be reimbursed their costs. We'll just have to see how it goes.
That's had to get turned off. Go ahead, Sam.
Sure.
Do we have any idea what, if we, is there any sort of comparable information on the comparable statutes in other regions of similar size?
I haven't bothered to ask. I will pass that question along to Jeff Blue and see if he's familiar with what other townships might be doing.
Ms. Petrie, did you have, and then
well, that was in essence, but I'd like to have a little bit more background as to what is the trigger mechanism for this, and I do understand them wanting to cover their costs, but do they pull this out of thin air, or is there some other reason? So that builds on what Mr. Shore asked.
Well, I do know that this ordinance was drafted by the same attorney who helped the Champaign County townships in the recent wind farm. And I think the feeling was that, you know, they actually had pretty stiff requirements for the wind farm, so why not? It made their approach to the wind farm look better if they would establish some kind of a permanent ordinance for any large project. And, you know, the wind farm, one wind farm tower is more than $1 million, and there were 30 towers in Champaign County. So we actually don't ever see anything similar to a wind farm. So it's the kind of a thing where, okay, that's a valid justification to adopt an ordinance. On the other hand, we will never see another wind farm approval, most likely. It's nice to have this in place if there is one. On the other hand, that fee based on $1 million value is not probably going to cover the cost of a wind farm, you know, all the work the townships put in on that. So I don't really know what the intent is. I think Jeff Blue didn't really know that much about this other than he knew that attorney helped them draft it. So we don't really have too much more information than you have in your agenda.
How small a project would trigger this?
Again, there really is no downward limit. I think it's actually going to depend on how each highway commissioner chooses to do this. Every new special use permit probably has a new driveway permit that they're going to have to get from the township authority. So, and that's my concern is, you know, I hope, now, I really have no reason to think that townships are going to go crazy and, because all they can ever get are their actual costs. Even if they require the $5,000 reimbursement to be set up for any project, all they can ever get out of there are their actual costs. And I don't think anybody could complain about that. So, but conceivably any project. You know, we had a special use permit recently for someone doing a catering kitchen out of their garage. That wasn't going to cost a whole lot, and but they needed a new driveway permit. So theoretically, that could require this to be set up. Now, that was already approved, so it's not applicable to that. But
in the future, say, a garage could trigger. A 30,000 garage could trigger.
A garage in and of itself doesn't require a special use permit. It's only if you're going to be doing something in that garage, like, we see contractors' facilities out in the rural area quite often. They need a special use permit. They may have to, you know, pay this fee.
For, a $30,000 workshop, they would have to pay $5,000?
Well, but again, all they really have to pay are the costs. And my impression is that a highway commissioner won't be doing a whole lot on something that small. So the actual cost should still be small, but you have to go to the trouble to set up the account, and then eventually you'll get it all back. So we'll see. And again, this is not a county issue anyhow. This is with the township road districts. But my concern is that if someone thinks it's unreasonable, it could cause a problem with one of our public hearings. But we don't have that problem yet. Hopefully it won't happen.
Is that all, Astrid?
Yeah.
Okay. Mr. Weibel.
Well, actually, your last statement sort of started what I want to talk about. I mean, this is not a county issue. It's a only in that there may be feedback to us. So it's really a township issue. I guess the question is how many townships have adopted this? I assume they all have to adopt it individually, correct?
I was told that they all adopted it.
They all adopted it.
Now,
apparently they liked it that well.
Apparently. But, you know, they'll be, each of them will be implementing it probably in their own way.
It'd be nice if we maybe got some copies of the real ordinance instead of this general one. You know, not all of them, but maybe places where you think it might be most popularly used.
I'll check with Jeff Blue to see if he's getting copies, and if he is, I'll ask to be copied.
Okay.
Yep. Mr. J.
Sorry, I don't have a microphone, but I will speak loudly. Is ag still exempt?
I don't believe agriculture is exempt from the local road district, but I'm not an expert in that.
I think we're opening up a Pandora's box because if I decide to build a huge machine shed and have to have a driveway to come in, I'm going to fall under this. And before, agriculture was exempt from these kinds of things. Now, all the road districts are in trouble, understand that. And they all need money, but they don't need them on the backs of our taxpayers.
Thanks to John. Mr. Schrader.
I have found with a preteen at home that when things get powered up and used, they don't get repowered. So I'm sitting here with my MacBook in front of Air Mac in front of me without any power to my battery. So I have to read my little screen on my iPhone, unfortunately, because my preteen is yet to understand the meaning of powering back up a device. With that being said, because I'm sure people are looking at me, thinking, oh, you reading your phone tonight, John? You having fun? Texting, are we? No, I'm trying to read the agenda and everything with it. I'm trying to stay paper free. So with that bit of nonsense, I've got real problems with that. because over the years, it's been my experience as farming and living in the townships that all the townships are different because they're run by different individuals. And the road commissioners, obviously, is the one I'm pertaining my comments to, and they all have little peccadilloes. And some, for example, some township road commissioners, if you want to put a farm culvert in to your field, a new one, would charge you, or you could buy your own culvert, and they might put it in place for you with a backhoe, and they may not. If you had one that needed to be replaced that's currently there, then they'll do that without any charge. But it's always been, at least in Posada and Sedoris Township, if you wanted a culvert put in a field, or if you had a driveway into your farmstead that you wanted to add to, you had to pay any kind of new ingress and egress. Now, John brought up United Prairie and actually Premier Co-op, and I used to sit on the Grand Prairie Cooperative Board, which oversaw, before the merger to Premier, oversaw United Prairie as a part of a two co-op system that owns it. And I remember that when Roger Woodworth was road commissioner at Tolono Township, that pretty much United Prairie and Premier had to build up that road right along the south edge of the property to an 80,000-pound road per Roger's prescription. He built one hell of an oil and chip road there. And it's taken several years of beating, and it's holding up real nice. But the thing, what concerns me, and the point I bring that up is, like I said, Premier, or actually Grand Prairie and United Prairie both chipped in to help buy that road. Taxpayers did too, but for the most part, they helped because they expanded the fertilizer division out there, and so they were going to use that road quite extensively. And the same thing applied when they added their fuel out there and a few more, they're adding more storage out there. But I also noticed too that there's a lot of people that use that as a cutout from the west side of Tolono. There's a lot of traffic. It goes, cuts through that township road, and then it heads north when it gets down to the T, and they run all the way down to Monticello Road where they can get on 57 right there, less than an eighth of a mile to the west, or they can keep going straight on Duncan, and they can get in the south side of Champaign. So there's probably more when you consider what United Prairie and Premier does, which is almost seasonal. Spring, fall, that road's pretty busy with their trucks. Beyond spring to fall, they're not really on those roads, whereas most of the residents of Tolono, the drive-through traffic, pound those roads especially 5 times a day, if not 7 times a day. So my point is, I'm trying to make is I live in a rural area and see drive-throughs, and it even happens in my area in Tolono or in Posada and Sedoris Township, where we have a lot of drive-through traffic coming from God knows where. It can come from Douglas County, and I use Douglas County too, roads. But my point is, I'm a little concerned about how we can go ahead and get into these fees when, in fact, I always assume because of the example I gave you with United Prairie and Grand Prairie, that the road the township road commissioners have a lot of power. And they have a lot of leverage, and I think in the past the leverage was if you have an unposted road, they can post it. And that kind of puts you in a pickle. So if United Prairie wanted to use a road with their 15-ton trucks, and if Mr. Woodworth decided to put a 3-ton posting on there, those trucks would sit. They wouldn't be able to move. So there was some of that going on, and a cooperative spirit among those who work and have businesses that reside in those townships, that, you know, if there was a fair share, an extra fair share to pay with the roads because of service, it usually was able to be worked out road commissioner. So when I see things like this, it really puts it into stone that you shall pay if you have this, and some of the stuff is enforceable, and some of it's, I mean, what is unenforceable, but it depends, like I said, when I first started, it depends on the personality, the individuals running the township road, and if you get crossways with that particular individual at all, you might want to see if you can beat them in an election, or you probably won't get very far if you want a culvert in your house, or you want a road or a ditch culvert for your farm or anything like that. That's been my experience. I try to be mostly genteel and friendly, and able to work with people, but sometimes it just doesn't happen with certain people. So it's very troubling to me to see this put in this way, and it gives a lot of power and discretion more than they currently have, and they have a lot of power, township commissioners, that, I'm kind of concerned about this, so I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Ms. Petrie.
It is not in our domain to make a decision on it, but it does affect the county, because if this is going to become an egregious amount for any economic development or businesses out there, that's going to hit the county. And I guess my concern is that this was done across the board, now we know, in all the townships in the county from what you've explained to us. And it's now presented to us, and there was no courtesy of conversation of coming to us and having any discussion or any input before they just went flat out. That does really bother me.
Mr. Schrader.
Just, I want to really agree with the chairwoman, because she's exactly right. I couldn't have said it better, so I'm glad you said it. It could have a fairly negative impact on some development or any kind of building out there in the county. And like you said, Patsy, it's unfortunate that we didn't have any townships come forward, and there was no discussion or anything. When I got the memo, it's the first I heard about it. So, and it's, you know, living out there in the townships like we do, it's very troubling to me. So I appreciate her word.
Anything, Mr. Weibel?
Just one last comment. I noticed that, you know, it's not actually a fee, it's a deposit. And then the road commissioner will actually presumably hire or pay for consultants or advisors, and the fees would go towards that, and any money left over would go back to the person who put the deposit down in the first place. I mean, that sounds a bit better, although there's, you know, still possible room for abuse in that system.
I would just note that in our own stormwater fees, we have a minimum that they have to pay to initiate the review, and then we get reimbursed for the total at the end. So that's a different way to go about it. It does, the way we go about it, we take the risk of not getting paid because we forget to charge everything. The way this goes about it, as you just said, there's a risk that someone may not actually get reimbursed all they're owed. Either way, it is a big headache, but it is a way to recoup costs. So, but our stormwater fee is the closest thing that I know of, and it is capped at $1,500 max.
Well, I assume that the money's not actually going to go to the road commissioner. Presumably, it's going to go pay for consultancy hires.
Actually, I think one part of this says that some of it can actually go for the staff.
Yeah. Well, possibly, but I'm thinking about what some of the examples that John has talked about. I suppose they could charge John some fees for installing the culvert or helping out with that or something like that. So, I mean, like I said, there's room for abuse. I think that if there's money left over, I'm sure the people could get it back. I sue the commissioner, I'm sure.
Mr. Shore.
Yeah. One thing that stuck out to me when I was reading this was this part in section 2, where the requesting party shall reimburse the road district for the time of road district employees required for reviews and site inspections at 2 times the respective hourly rate. And so I don't know if that's customary for it to be double the required hourly respective hourly rate, or where that comes from, because that stuck out to me.
Yeah, I assume that just goes to ensure that all of the township fees would be recovered, the direct salary plus the overhead and things like that.
Anything else? good discussion. Seeing nothing else, we'll move on then to 7D, regulation of coolants in closed-loop geothermal well systems to protect groundwater. And Susan's going to speak to that and even has some up on the screen.
Yeah, I have a short PowerPoint just to help assure myself that I won't forget anything. Since this memo went out, we've gotten some additional feedback with regard to one of the major concerns about this topic of regulating coolants to limit the coolant used to only food grade USP propylene glycol. That was the original concern that we were looking into. The use of toxic coolants are currently allowed, and we're exploring options available to the county board to consider implementing a potential regulation to prohibit the leaking, you know, any potential for leaking of toxic coolants into the groundwater. So essentially, the two considerations that we are providing you an update about are the authority of the county to actually do this is in question at present, and we are awaiting a formal opinion from the Assistant State's Attorney, the Office of the State's Attorney, and it's a definite maybe kind of thing at the moment. So there's a good reason to potentially look into proceeding and instituting this kind of regulation. One county in Illinois has done it so far, Macon County. Illinois Department of Public Health is not aware of any other counties that have done this yet. So, I want to talk about the actual code and some proposed amendments to the code that are coming up. So this will just take a few minutes. Geothermal wells are regulated by the Illinois Water Well Construction Code and by the Illinois Water Well Pump Installation Code. And there's a whole series of proposed amendments coming up being proposed by the Illinois Department of Public Health to the Illinois Water Well Construction Code. And some of those involve which type of coolants could be used. So the existing code doesn't even address the or limit any kind of use of coolant. So the Water Well Construction Code, as it exists, as I just mentioned, doesn't even address the issue of limiting or type of coolant that can be used. And even with the proposed changes to this code, this is one of many considerations being considered. So timing could be an issue. Does the county want to proceed and just prohibit any use of anything but food grade coolants, or does the county want to just wait and see what happens at the state level with the proposed amendments coming up, and we'll go forward. The definition section outlines and defines what a closed loop well is, talking about the heat exchanger and the liquid solution referencing the coolant. The provision in the proposed amendment is that heat exchange fluid that is pumped through the closed loop well piping shall be water or a mixture of water and methanol, ethanol, or USP food grade propylene glycol. So I did provide an attachment which provided a general idea of the type of coolants used, some of which are toxic. Methanol is flammable and toxic. Ethanol is like alcohol from fermenting of sugars and starches, not noted as being toxic. Ethylene glycol is probably the worst. It's a poisonous kind of alcohol used in antifreezes and stuff. You can tell I'm not a chemist here. This is just a layperson's view of the type of coolants. And then we have propylene glycol or higher grades of that, USP food grade propylene glycol, and that is used everywhere, this stuff. So this attachment is pretty useful just to get an overview of the types of coolants out there. So this graphic simply talks about the existing set of the code, doesn't even address it, the type of coolants. The earlier draft had addressed certain mixtures by percentage that could be allowed, and then that draft has already been amended to be more general in nature. So The person at the Illinois Department of Public Health, David Johnson, who does review of all of these kinds of county ordinances and county health ordinances that pertain to allowing a county to permit wells, including geothermal wells, says that this is coming forward in October to go through the JCAR rulemaking process. This set of amendments will be considered. There will be an initial public review period of 45 days, and then written comments will happen, and then there's going to be a follow-up public review period. And I propose that ELEC members consider, you know, tracking this and seeing what happens and providing commentary as you see appropriate as this moves forward. So again, we're at this point where we have the option to consider just going ahead and adopting a regulation to limit and restrict the use of coolants in a closed-loop well system to food-grade, USP-rated food-grade propylene glycol, which is considered safe in the event of a leak, or to watch and see what unfolds at the state level and provide public input and comment to support one option or another. I did some additional research about pricing of different types of coolants, and essentially the USP-rated food-grade coolant is a couple of dollars more per gallon. Both types of propylene glycol, the regular kind and the food-grade kind, are easily available. Ordered online from any kind of chemical supply company, no restrictions on who can order it. It's not a big problem to get the stuff, is what I'm saying. And I have collected a lot of information about this, but I thought it would be good to bring this forward to you just so you had an update about where we are in this process.
Okay, any questions, comments, Ms. Petrie?
Thank you, Susan. I do have a number. First of all, can you detail a little bit more exactly what Macon County put in place?
Well, it's a pretty standard kind of template for a closed loop well system. And they have one provision, or section 4, which is a one sentence provision that says essentially that only USP food grade propylene glycol can be used as a heat exchange fluid in Macon County, Illinois. And so that was approved by the Illinois Department of Public Health. And then, you know, I thought, wow, they did this. You know, they're a non-home rule county, just like Champaign County. How did they do this? And so it just led to a bunch of questions in my mind. How can they have the authority to do this? So that's what our state's attorney's office is looking into, because it's not addressed in the Illinois Department of Public Health code. It's not addressed what kind of coolants can be used. And they went ahead and they specified what they want used. So that's the question, essentially, that the legal question that we're looking into.
Okay. Then my second question is, this is checked by the Public Health Department. This isn't checked by planning and zoning. Did you ask them how many wells are out in the county now and how many wells are on the drawing board so we have some sense of...
Yeah.
Those facts, and what is the window of time if there are some wells on the drawing board for us to sit back and take your advice to watch this, or if we really want to move forward for some more serious action?
I did have that same question to the county public health staff that do well permitting and inspecting, and I didn't write down the answer, but I do recall that last year was about, I believe, a total of 15 or so, and I can check these figures for you. And this year, so far, to date, for some reason, there's a lull of only 14 permit applications at this point in the year. So it's variable. I talked to Macon County, and they have much higher rates. Maybe there's just more going on out there as far as well digging. But their rates were up in the 19-20 range per year. I don't know if I'm answering your question specifically.
Continue.
My follow-up is, in all the discussions that are going on in the rule setting, is there anything going to be said as a rule that
those that are already dug and have fluids in them, that those then be replaced if the county passes such an ordinance, or will they just be grandfathered in the state they're in?
Well, I talked to the Macon County Health Department about how they handle those kind of issues, and essentially a variance request is issued or made, or some kind of variance review happens when it's time to expand or rebuild an existing system. If the coolant use is something other than USP food grade coolant, but you're asking a slightly different question about existing systems, and when they need a permit, I guess, is when they need to be rebuilt. So I can find out.
Well, I'm asking if they're out there, is there going to be anything in these rules that say that what is presently in there that is not is toxic be replaced with the food grade should a rule gets changed or an ordinance within the county gets passed?
I don't have an answer. It's a good question. It seems like it would be difficult to do that, but John, have you ever heard of that happening in a permitting situation?
I would be very surprised if we can make them change what's in there. If this fluid ever needs to be replaced, I think we could address that. But I'm pretty certain that, you know, if that system is already in place and working fine, it would get to stay there.
Okay.
Mr. Harper.
Susan, do you know if the contractors are doing this, what they're using?
I did sort of get I made a few calls to some contractors, and they were pushing for use of food, not for the use of the USP food grade coolant, only probably because of the slightly additional cost and inconvenience of trying to get that possibly. But both products are available. I didn't get the reason really why they were, one was pushing for, let's just use propylene glycol. It doesn't need to be USP food grade. I don't think that person actually got the whole point of, you know, in case of leaks, the toxic kind of groundwater contamination. So to answer your question, all of the products are out there. The Macon County contractors working in Macon County are using USP food grade coolant. So,
well, it would make Patsy happier, use me for a test study. I have a loop system with geothermal right now, so, and I don't know what's in it. So,
is yours a well system?
It's a loop system. I have the loop.
Oh, okay, well, the loops, yeah, they
yeah,
are.
Loops, not, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Just asking. Ms. Berkson, and microphone, please.
The county has some heat pumps, doesn't it?
You know, that's a very good question, too. I don't know.
So then you don't know what's in ours.
I could find out. Maybe John knows.
Yeah.
Highway
transportation.
Yeah.
So aired.
Good question. I guess I have one just real quick. Susan, you're saying, just the way you're saying it, at least over in Macon County, you can only use the USP. But I assume you could use, because it is mentioned, and I don't know why you couldn't. It's just maybe not as efficient. You could just use water, I would assume, still.
In fact, the guy from the state, David Johnson, said Richland Community College uses only water in their system. Somehow they can do that. I'm not sure how, but.
Yeah, I would think it would just be kind of like in your car. It's just not as efficient a transmitter of the different temperature water, so it's maybe not as efficient to have to pump more through it per hour or something, but you would still be able to use that, I would assume, in Macon County if you really wanted to. Yeah.
Any so other? I'd be happy to provide an update in October to see where we are, or do you just want to let go of this issue or see how it unfolds? We can get a more definitive opinion from the state's attorney's office. We have a lot of options here.
Mr. Shore?
Given the state of our state, we should probably not let it go too much and just kind of keep an eye on it.
Any other thoughts?
Well, I would be curious to finally get the opinion of the state's attorney to see if we have any authority, or Macon County has gone on the theory of
asking forgiveness after they've done something. You know, bravo for them if that's the case.
Okay, thank you.
Guess I would say, sounds like we're probably all pretty much in agreement. Definitely doesn't hurt to keep on top of it. And if you could give us a brief update, maybe in October, does that sound right? Agreeable to everyone? Thanks, Susan. Then I believe you have the next one, too. Information 7E, the proposed consent decree.
Well, you're all aware that next Tuesday is the day that we'll have legal counsel present here to lead any or respond to any questions you may have about the consent decree. I, like many others, including you, have been scrambling to understand the consent decree in detail and been listening to various committee of the whole meetings that have occurred, and I found the testimony to be quite interesting, and especially the testimony of the former Illinois Pollution Control Board chair, a local person, John Marlin. So his testimony was quite interesting at the Urbana Committee of the Whole. That's coming up on Tuesday. If any of you have questions you want to forward to our state's attorney's office, we can try to get answers for you from Barb Mann. But the sooner you get those questions to us, the better.
Mr. Schrader.
So, Susan, it's my understanding that the city of Urbana passed this in committee of the whole, but not yet the whole city council meeting?
Well, they considered it at the committee of the whole and just forwarded it without a recommendation to their city council meeting.
But City of Champaign has already approved it?
Yes, they have. It was not a unanimous vote, 6-2.
Okay, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to talk over you.
Sir.
How many more committee, excluding us and Urbana, how many more communities are needed to approve this?
Well, I believe Savoy is looking at it either today or yesterday. Just really presently, they're looking at it. There's their village. I know one county, Piatt, passed it with no discussion, at least at their council meeting or board meeting. I don't have the tally, but it's in progress now.
Yeah, I just looked up just for a little information. I'm not sure if this is the absolute closest, but as of September, excuse me, Joe Hooker sent this email out. His count, he says, and he even says it's unofficial. This was after the city, Champaign City Council voted 6-2 in favor of approving the consent decree. He says Monticello, Tuscola, McLean County, and the city of Champaign have approved it, is what he had here as of September 1st at 8:52.
Okay, so that was McLean County, not Piatt. Excuse me.
I didn't think Piatt.
Okay, sorry. So, yeah, 14 local governments in total. So.
Ms. Petrie? Yeah.
Okay, what I'm sharing with you are things that I've heard from, questions I've heard from constituents, all right? And one of them is, are there any other forms of maintenance that need to be required other than what is in the consent decree to make certain about the safety? This doesn't cover coal ash as when, that's a question mark. Somebody was asking about, even though liability is mentioned in your number 5 of your narrative here, there's still somebody asked about the long-term liability. This is only 30 years, and if there are contaminants that eventually show up in the test wells, that's really after the fact, not before the fact. So the person wanted to know about that. And are the tests that you discuss in item number 4 defined as to procedure and exactness? And then the last question, which nobody seems to have a consensus on, does everybody everybody who's listed in the consent decree, do they all need to sign on to make it an effective decree? or is it a majority? If one entity decides not to sign on, what happens to it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Patsy. Those are all excellent questions, and I would, yeah. I've heard answers, but I would defer to the legal counsel that will be present on Tuesday. I'll make sure they are aware of these. Yeah. I can say with certainty that coal ash is not addressed in the consent decree and that the legislation needs to be changed to even address that statewide. So other than that.
I have one other question. The way it's worded here, this is only protecting a landfill in that might be over the Muhammad Aquifer in DeWitt County. The aquifer goes 14 counties. So the presence of this doesn't have a whole lot of teeth.
It's a very focused consent decree.
Anyone else? Mr. Shore.
Just to one of Patsy's questions, it at least says in here that the order shall become effective only when executed by all parties of the consent order in the court, but then it goes on to say it may be executed by the parties in one or more counterparts. So it seems like, yes, it has to be all, but if there are some stragglers, maybe we'll just go ahead in the meantime.
It's a mind twister.
Mr. Harper.
The gentleman that were here from DeWitt County, they were more they were concerned about the coal ash that could still be added to this landfill. I mean, you can't put any more of the PCPs, right? Is that the way it's set up? Okay.
Yeah, none of those, but they
could
mentioned
they still put the coal ash in it?
Yes. And then all the right. Manufactured gas byproduct that's right. Still there. Okay. That's there.
I'm trying to refresh.
They're
going to
be able to add to it, but it can stay. I believe.
And there's nothing there about cleaning up existing waste. I've been sitting here thinking about it. How long, I mean, maybe the two Johns, how long has that landfill been there at Clinton?
I'm not that old, I can't tell you.
We're not voting on that, John. I just curious because, you know, I said, well, if you force them to clean it up, which, you know, I go back to John a couple of years ago, who had the right mind and common sense would build a landfill on top of a water source. But if you go in there and try to disturb what's already there, it could be more hazardous than just leaving it sit there. Go ahead, John.
Mr. Schrader.
Well, I'm sorry if I digress into a talk about landfills and garbage dumps, but there's all over the place there's landmines like that. That one was a kid down Villa Grove. I remember hauling stuff down there that someday that's going to be a problem. Well, I was a kid, I said. The parties you want to implicate are long gone. But even the Urbana one out here, there's some nasty stuff in there too. So I'd hate to add any more problems we already currently have. So I'll be interested to hear what we hear Tuesday evening next week.
Any other comments, questions? Are we ready to move on? Thanks again, Susan. Okay, we will move on then to line 8, items to be approved by ELUC. We have the recreation and entertainment license for the River to Rail Ride Band, Middle Fork River Forest Preserve Activity Center at 3485 County Road 2700 East. Pinfield, to be held September 19th, 2015. And I'll note, this is the one that was pulled off of last month's agenda because we didn't have the full information. So, moved by Mr. Shore.
Seconded
by Ms. Berkson. Any questions, comments? Mr. Harper.
What is this River to Rail Ride? What's the purpose of it?
It's a fundraiser for the rail trail that the Forest Preserve District is helping to build. So they have some bike rides that are organized as part of this. That does not need committee approval. It's just the live music.
And, of course, that rail's the one from Urbana to Danville eventually. Mr. Schrader.
Stan, just a comment. That's a beautiful place out there. I know you're not that far away from me. You don't have to take your bike out there, but just go out and enjoy that park out there. It's a beautiful place. It's the only place where we've preserved a peat bog, and it's just a delightful place. We've got great waterfowl areas, and it's a real star. It's a star in the cap of this county. So you can just go out and watch. It'd be all right.
Anything else before we vote? And seeing none, all in favor of approval, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay.
Aye.
Oh, that was a nay. Okay. That is fine. Okay. That does pass, but not unanimously. We will move on to 9 then. Items for recommendation to the county board. Request to adopt the Champaign County Multi-Jurisdictional Hazard Mitigation Plan update. And back to Susan, I believe.
Right, this draft is a final draft, which we are still finding minor errors in and correcting. So we have today just corrected a few other minor typo kind of things. But all in all, it's in process of being reviewed and adopted by each of the participating local governments. So far, we have about a quarter of them already adopting this, and now it's the question goes forward to the county board. This would be an update of the existing plan that places the county in a good position to be eligible for various forms of disaster assistance and hazard mitigation grant funding, should those funds be available, generally a match program. So this does do good things. It does have good impacts as far as the mitigation actions that each local government agrees to look at trying to do. So it's a good thing, I would say, with no downside.
Mr. Weibel.
I'll move to approve to forward to the county board for adoption by the full board.
Moved by Mr. Weibel. Seconded by Ms. Berkson. Thank you, Mr. Weibel. Okay, now open for... Go ahead, Ms. Petrie.
Susan, is the approval of this dependent on all the different entities signing on?
Each local jurisdiction needs to adopt it in order to be eligible. That particular jurisdiction, local government, needs to be... have an adopted plan in order to apply for various types of assistance. Thank you. Two questions always that get asked are, do you have an approved adopted hazard mitigation plan? And then the other question is, do you participate in the National Flood Insurance Program? So this takes care of both of those questions for many of the jurisdictions.
Any other questions, comments? Well, this would be, this would go, if we approve it here, it goes to the county board, but if we do it unanimously, unless you want it kept
up. No, I wasn't
Because
she said everybody had signed on and they found some more things.
Well, those are just...
The plan itself is a multi-jurisdictional plan. Only the county would only be interested in the local, the mitigation actions, considering implementing the mitigation actions listed for the county only. There's no obligation to do anything for any jurisdiction.
So if they do or don't adopt it, that's their problem, I guess. Right. You could say. Okay, ready to vote? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, nay. Okay, thank you. That passes unanimously. We'll then move on to line item 10, the monthly reports for July of 2015. Any questions, comments to be made on those? And seeing none, we will accept those and place them on file. We'll move on then to other business. Ms. Petrie, I believe, had.
Yes, I have two just information questions for Susan.
Would you catch us up on the progress on the burning ordinance that you've been working on, and it got expanded to not only leaves but also trash? I know that. And then the other is, I understand you are now working on Wilbur Heights, and if you could sort of catch us up, the progress that's being made along that. Thanks.
Okay, so with regard to the burn ordinance situation, essentially, the last time the board looked at this, ELUC looked at it, was in 2007, and at that point, there was a draft ordinance being looked at with a burn restriction area of essentially 1 mile from a population of 1,000 persons. And at that time, one of the major problems or challenges was to identify alternatives available to citizens in those areas. So that's more or less the approach that we're taking now. We're looking at alternatives to consider should such an ordinance be on the table. So we have various things to look at. We're in process of setting up meetings with the townships surrounding the denser populated areas in the central part of the county, especially. We're looking at existing options or potential options that may be feasible with the landscape recycling center. We're also aware of some legislation that just was adopted at the state level with regard to composting and loosening up of requirements for compost centers, so that may be an easier thing for perhaps township governments to consider, or easier for a local jurisdiction to consider doing either a one-day event or becoming a composting facility. There are also the other options of just encouraging education and outreach to do home composting. So we're looking at a variety of alternatives along with proposal of a burn ordinance this time, and coming forward to you hopefully in a month, maybe in 2 months, but we're shooting for a month with some options to consider there. So that's just an overview update. There's a lot to look at. We're uncovering challenges every time we look closely at it. There's another challenge that pops up. So it's a very interesting question. And by the way, the Illinois EPA regional representative would be thrilled if the county would adopt a burn ordinance. As you know, calls are made frequently where fire department staff or a fire protection district volunteers need to go out with the sheriff department, perhaps. And it's a very expensive kind of, you know, problem for those involved. So to the degree that we can lessen those kind of calls or complaints, that would be great for all. Any other questions about that project? John, did you want to add anything at this point? With regard to the Wilbur Heights, essentially I've been pushing away other projects to have time to devote to that, and am looking forward to actually getting to it. It's like reached the point of my desk where I can no longer look anywhere else but at that project. So public meetings need to be set up, and I need to touch base with the city of Champaign as soon as possible. So that's a high priority project for me to spend some time with at this point. Thank you.
Anything else for other business? I have no chair's report, so we'll move on then to the semi-annual review of closed session minutes. Is John, do you know what the state's attorney's? Or Mr. Weibel?
Well, I'll make a motion that all the closed session minutes remain closed because we haven't had a chance to relook at them. It doesn't say how we have to approve them, so I'll just move they remain closed.
Moved by what? Mr. Weibel, seconded by Ms. Berkson. Thank you. Any comments on that? Okay, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed, nay. Okay, that passes. Thank you. Designation of items to be placed on consent agenda. We did pass item 9, the request for the hazard mitigation plan passed unanimously. That's it. And with that, is there a motion to adjourn? Moved and seconded by Ms. Berkson. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. We're adjourned. Thank you.